And as we sit here, the families of British Israeli citizens that were kidnapped by Hamas are also giving their own address. Let's take a listen.
The news of civilians being kidnapped only started circulating around noon. So until noon, I didn't even imagine the possibility. I just thought I've lost them. And all I wanted was my other brother and my friends and my friends' families out, because I figured this tragedy hit me. It's going to hit me really hard. I don't want anyone else to go through what I'm about to go through. Around noon, the news about the kidnapping started circulating, and then I started thinking maybe the pictures were proof of life. Maybe they were taking. I didn't even know what was the better option, being killed or being kidnapped by Hamas. So it was a waiting period until around 7 in the evening, when the army managed to get to my mom and my brother's house, and I got a phone call from their kibbutz telling me my mom and my brother were missing. And so was my older brother. I wasn't in touch with him all day because we never spoke during a missile attack or an event. We always spoke after. So I wasn't in touch with him. I was informed he was missing too. His phone was found in his house. The next day, 9 o'clock in the morning, I drove to the nearest police station to my house to file a formal missing persons report and to submit my DNA. And as I went into the police station, I received a phone call from my family's kibbutz that my oldest brother, Roy, who was 54, was found, his body was found at daylight. He was shot dead behind his house, murdered. So I filed a missing report for my mom and my brother. The mass casualties bodies are still being identified as we speak because of the numbers and because of the conditions of those who were murdered. 18 days later, my brother's body hasn't been identified officially just yet. I'm 46 years old. My life at the moment is worrying for my diabetic mom and brother, who are being held by Hamas. My mother needs insulin shots. I don't know if she's getting them and how long she can survive without them. And then, on the other hand, I'm chasing dental records and x-rays and filing forms asking me if my brother had scars or tattoos, or which he didn't. So trying to identify my brother so we can bury him and bring him to rest. And then bringing my mom and my other brother home. So this has been my life for the last 18 days. I find it when I ask people what day is it, they say Monday or Tuesday, and I count by numbers. No, it's day 18. My life stopped on the 7th of October. I try not to deal with my loss of my brother at the moment because I find it too painful, and if I start thinking about that, then it will hurt too much and it'll break me, and I don't have the privilege of breaking because I have a mission and I need to be efficient and effective and productive, trying to get the Red Cross to our family members to see them, to get lists of who's been taken. These are 18 days later. We haven't had any information. Are they getting the medications that they need? So we're chasing information. We're trying to get the hostages' help, and we're trying to get information out. And we don't have that just yet. I'll show you the... This is my mom. She was supposed to be in London now on a holiday with my brother Nadav. They've had the tickets booked, a hotel, shows. On Sunday, I had to cancel everything because they were in Gaza and they're still there. This picture was taken on their last trip on the airport on the way to London because they came here often. This is my brother Nadav, he's 51. They're just simple people living on a small agriculture community. A kibbutz is the closest thing you can imagine to a village where everybody knows everyone. We all go to the same schools. I know people from the kibbutzes around us. It's that type of a community. We're farmers. My brother, who was murdered, worked in the dairy many years, like my dad did for 35 years. My dad passed away years ago. I worked in the dairy as a young teenager. This is the life we lived. It's a quiet, simple, peaceful life that's been shattered to pieces on October 7th. And all we did was work in the fields and milk the cows. And now my brother is dead. And my family is being held against their will in Gaza, and I'm here to raise awareness for my family, for all families who have young children and Holocaust survivors and young women and men, elderly, in medical need. And I'm here to speak for my family and and to be the voice for everyone who can't be here with us now. This is a humanitarian crisis. This is a crime, a war crime, and the hostages have to be released and returned. This isn't a political issue. This is a human crisis, and we demand the return of our loved ones home so we can start healing from this trauma.